Good morning, church. Let's start with number 241.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy.
Sing like never. Father, we want to thank you for this time you set aside for us to come together in fellowship to worship and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Katie has something.
I have something?
Yes. Introduce the two of you, because maybe
Hi,
some people...
Hi, I'm Elaine Trevino. It's nice to see you all. I sit in the back most weeks.
And I'm Katie.
All right, announcements. We had a food bank yesterday. We did 1,500 and...
60-some.
60-something?
I thought yeah. It was 80-something. It might have been 68.
We did. That's a lot.
A lot.
It's a lot.
It was hot out there. no Monday, but we do have watermelon. Yeah, so we're going to set up a couple Gaylords of watermelon today. Take
them home.
Take them home. Jennifer, can you post that we're going to have those out there today? Thank you. Wednesday night Bible study with Miss Jennifer. Dangerous Prayer is her study this next few weeks. And then at the end of that, you get me. Sorry.
So. Celebrate Recovery Monday night.
Celebrate Recovery on Monday night. You guys had a good crowd here Monday.
Yeah.
It's good. It's good. So... It's off. It's off. I'm just too high. Let's see what else we got this week.
I got a little something. I brought copies of the Constitution for the Sunday school, but I have this many left. If any of you would like a copy of the Constitution, I would be glad to give you one. Those of you with people in Sunday school will get them.
We are going to need people next Saturday for the food bank so that we can run it. We need about 50 bodies there to make it work right, because some of us are going to be missing. I'm going to be up at Kids Day. After that, bring the kids up to Kids Day. That's at Maricopa Wells from 10 to 4. But it's going to be a busy day for all of us. And I have another announcement. Somebody here loves me. Lucy actually brought me a lobster, so stay out of it.
Also, because I want to be open and upfront with all of you, so our insurance here at the church quadrupled this year because of the fire and two other injury claims that we had. Our old insurance company dropped us. And getting anybody to even cover us, even through the Christian ministries that we were working through before, there's still three quotes out there that we're trying to get. So that we didn't have a gap, we were able to find insurance, but it was $11,000 almost for the year. Now, what that means for us is, luckily, Gail was amazing in her foresight. And she was able to put a reserve fund of about $7,000, correct? About $7,000. So we were able to cover it this year. I don't know what that's going to look like next year. I am working diligently with Joe Keetring from Christian Ministries to try to find us a cheaper option. But what I need from all of you right now is prayer. We need prayer. Prayer for the church finances so that we can continue our mission here. And we still have a giant $1 million project going up outside at the same time. So please, 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 prayer. I know that God will show up in the 11th hour because that's the way he does things. And He will provide, but we need to be praying, okay?
I'm praying he shows up at 6:30 because I'm not real bright, and I don't want to miss it.
All right, that's all I have. Jim, do you have anything else?
No, that's pretty much it, except we do have a potluck after church. So stay, eat with us, stay out of my lobster. Alice is doing well. She's having a ball with the grandkids in Texas. I'm going to be leaving on the 27th, and then me and her will be back on the 13th. And I'm holding up well. I've done the dishes. I've done the laundry. But if Alice came home right now, I'd be dead because of the living room. Okay, it's a nightmare. So say a prayer for me. I need it.
All right, Jim. Take us into prayer.
I think that's it. You guys missed an excellent Bible study at 9 o'clock. We were talking about, Mike was talking about Daniel. And you really should come to these because we learn a lot and we get to discuss it. And he brought up something that really touched my heart, that we need to be praying for the sins of each other because we all have sins. That's just the way it is. None of us are perfect. You're real close, Lucy. I love you, but you still got sin too. I'm giving her a break because she's been so great to me. But no, we need to be praying for each other and each other's sins and the sins of this world because God hears prayers, and we need to take that to heart. You know, we pray for the people we know that have cancer and, you know, people that need healing, and we should continue doing that too. But we need to be praying about everything for this world because this world is going to hell real fast, and it's the prayers that are going to keep us going and keep us on track. So as we lift up our cancer buddies, Joanne McDover, Karen Story, Robert Kiesker, Anna Maria, Cynthia Bryce, Holly Harrier, Jim Ayala, Tiffany, Judy Puzzi, David, Jamie Missy, Glenn Morse, Joe Galen, Rose, Keith Geib, Paul Talbot, Natalie Collins, Maria, Diana Lamont, Mike Moore, Chris, Kathy Carroll, Carrie, Ezekiel. There's so many. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, before I lift these up, Lord, we humble ourselves before you and ask forgiveness for the sins that we have committed, not only the ones that we know of, but the ones that we don't know of, and we've just committed them stupidly and not paying attention. We know you are a forgiving God, and we love you for that. And we do. We humble ourselves before you and ask you to lift up all of these that have these terrible diseases, cancer and leukemia. And, you know, we give them to you, Lord. We ask that you would bless them and heal them. We ask that you would touch their lives, touch the lives of their family, and let them know that you're there, Lord. And let your spirit flow around them. And the Christians that are around them, Lord, strengthen them that they can help these people through these terrible times and comfort them. Because our comfort comes from you, Lord, and we all know that. Lord, we ask you to heal those that need healing. But most of all, Lord, we ask you to touch the hearts of those that do not know you. Allow us to be the vessels that you work through. We do offer ourselves for that, Lord. That's why we ask for our forgiveness of our sins, that we can be those vessels and that we can bring others to Christ and to you, for it's a terrible thing to go to die and not know where you're going, to be so afraid. And Lord, we ask you to touch all of those. We give them to you that your will would be done in all their lives. All the ones that we mentioned this morning, Lord, we give them to you that your will would be done in their lives. Because whatever that will is, we know that it's a miracle and that it's precious. Because it's the will of God, and we will find comfort in that. Lord, we ask you as we go into this next service that you would just fill this building with your spirit, Lord. Touch each and every one of us and let us know that you're here. Let us feel your presence among us and inside of us, working with us. We give you Pastor Mike and ask you to just let him be the vessel that you speak through. Give us the words that we need to hear, that our hearts and minds would become attentive and understand your words. Lord, we pray for this church and this community. Pray for this nation and the world, Lord, that you would bring a revival, that they would fall to their knees and honor you again. Lord, this nation that was founded under God, Lord, we ask that you would bring it back to that, that we would be able to get on our knees before you, and people would cherish that and cherish you. Lord, we do love and praise you in Jesus' name, and we give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Are there any others? Let's worship in song. Always do that, don't I? Always wrap up your mic.
All right. We're going to go to number 31.
He who began a good work in you
to number 174.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved us. blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone.
You guys are staying in here today.
I forgot to mention it's Constitution Week is why I got the Constitution.
Okay. Our kid's going to stay in here today.
Lollipops.
Okay, we're good.
See that? You guys already got yours because Jennifer.
Wait.
Huh? I got one that's root beer flavor. Is that your favorite? No. No, you don't get them until you quietly sit without hitting each other. I see you guys already split up because you know you're not going to be good. Good job. Quietly sit and listen, okay? That way Lucy doesn't get on me about leaving you in here. Okay, so it happened again this week. Okay, so you guys see my Wish Jesus shirt, right? The title of today's message is One Nation Under God. I'm going to tell you what happened. I was out feeding chickens this morning, and for some reason, 2 Chronicles 7, 14 through 16. Now, it may be because I just didn't want to feed chickens today, but I decided to rewrite my sermon at 6 o'clock this morning. I'm probably going with, I just didn't want to feed chickens this morning. So, no, I was asked last week by the veteran community to do the prayers for the memorial walk tomorrow. And I've been really kind of working on that this week, and it just really touched my heart. I was like, you know what, I got to say something. So do you guys know what September 11th is? Okay, do you know what national holiday it is? Did you know it's a national holiday? It is. It's, let's see, I had to grab Jennifer's phone because I couldn't remember all of the national holidays that we have on September 11th. It's National Hot Cross Bun Day, National Boss and Employee Exchange Day. It's No News is Good News Day. And this is why the kids are in here today. Okay? It's National Make Your Bed Day. What? I'm not kidding. I didn't make this up. I didn't make it up.
September 11th is it's 9/11 as well.
That's right. It's Patriot Day, okay? Patriot Day is September 11th. We must never forget. Ever. So I brought up 7:14 through 16 because it reads this way. And my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer offered in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house that my name may be there forever, and my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. I'm not going to get too much further in it because I think we need to pray first. So let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you again for this time you've set aside for us to come together in fellowship and to worship you. Lord, as we go about today, we just ask that your spirit flow freely and let my words be your words. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now you guys know the devil works diligently, right? I feel the last couple weeks, Satan has been working overtime. He's got double time, okay? He's getting paid double time, and he's working on us real hard. I'm going to tell you what happened. I almost printed this sermon this morning without the page numbers, and I was like, not today, Satan. Not today. I got you. So let's get into it. So we must never forget. How can any of us forget the early hours of that fateful Tuesday morning on September 11th, 2001. It doesn't really, to me, it doesn't seem really that long ago, does it? But there's an entire generation over here, and there's a couple of them over there. They weren't there for that, okay? Many of us had poured our morning cup of coffee and turned on the television just to watch the morning news. And then we watched as our entire world was shaken. I don't know if you guys felt this way, but I did. I stared at that TV screen in utter disbelief. I thought, when I seen that first plane hit the first tower, I thought, oh my gosh, what a tragedy. How could something like this happen? I mean, what a terrible accident, right? And then the second plane hit. What is going on with traffic control? And then the third plane. And I realized this was no accident. I still tear up today thinking about it. How could this be so well orchestrated, yet no one even knew it was coming? How could this happen to our country with such sophisticated intelligence? It was as if we were watching a horror movie as we witnessed these airplanes crashing into the World Trade Center towers, watching the towers topple, a diverted tragedy in Pennsylvania, and a thwarted attempt to harm thousands of people in the Pentagon in our nation's capital. Air travel was immediately dispelled, and our skies were quiet for the first time in our history. At least my history, anyway. I don't think there's anybody alive before the airplane was made. So, My mom was on travel at the time. She actually worked for the VA at the time. She was in National. And I want to say she was maybe in Reno. I don't recall where she was at, but I remember the fiasco of trying to get mom back home. We awaited some word that would help us to make sense of it all. But that word wouldn't come for a long, long time. And even now, 22 years later, I think some of us still search for that answer. I'm going to pick on you, Major. Major Harvey, can I call you Major? Or Matt? You just prefer Matt? Okay. Okay. Why'd you join?
Funny you bring it up. I joined June 2001.
June of 2001.
I was at Advanced Individual Training, Landmine Warfare 206 Bottom Training Area. So I went in to get a college degree, get out of 4 years, and 22 years later, here I am.
There you are. Well, we thank you. Thank you. And you're quite a bit older than I am. I didn't realize that. Whoa. I was, what was I, 13 years old? Yeah. I know I look a lot older than I am. I had a rough life. It's the chickens. Definitely the chickens. Yeah. We need to tell Jennifer she needs to feed more. Get those chickens off. No, I joined because of that day. I said, not again. So we watched as our nation was under attack before our eyes. It was no longer a real Russian threat or finally the work of communists under our heads, our beds, but the works of an unknown group of terrorists who called themselves Al-Qaeda. 22 years ago, most Americans couldn't place Iraq or Iran on a map, let alone understand the differences. I remember, do you guys remember the Alan Jackson song? Where were you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Where were you when the world stopped turning? His refrain, I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things he gave us. And the greatest thing, the greatest of these things is love. And I remember 22 years ago, as the day's events unfold, our nation's leaders gathered on the steps of our Capitol, joined hands, and sang, God bless America, together. We must never forget. And was it really 22 years ago when we as a nation turned to God when everything else made no sense? Was it 22 years ago when our churches saw visitors for the first time seeking answers only God could provide, and it wasn't Easter Sunday? Was it really 22 years ago when we sifted through the rubble and buried over 3,000 people from all walks of life? Was it really 22 years ago when our world changed before our very eyes and we became one nation under God, once again? What happened in 22 years? This ensuing war cost an excess of $8 trillion. Somewhere between 905,000 and 940,000 directly related deaths, and somewhere in the ballpark of 4.9 million indirect deaths. This number is likely higher because it is hard to measure. But I'm going to throw out another number, and you've heard it. You say it a couple times a day. 22. 22 of our American veterans commit suicide every single day. Every single day. My friends, my brothers, my sisters committed suicide because of what happened 22 years ago tomorrow. Do you know what that equates to over 22 years? 22 years of every day an American soldier committing suicide for 22 years, every single day. That's 176,660. So those numbers are higher than I even have down on this paper. The United States of America was founded upon Christian principles. Look closely to our early American leaders and see where they put their trust. Godly men and women who relied on their faith through Jesus Christ to mold us into the nation we are today. We became a new nation because of religious persecution. We declared our independence from Great Britain because the king was the authority instead of God. I want you to read, I'm going to read the words of George Washington when he sent a letter to each state's governor. And what he said was, "I now make it my earnest prayer that God would have you and the state over which you preside in his holy protection, and he would incline the hearts of the citizens to cultivate a spirit of subordination and obedience to government, to entertain a brotherly affection and love for one another, for their fellow citizens of the United States at large, and particularly for their brethren who have served in the field, and finally, that he would most graciously be pleased to dispose us all to do justice, to love mercy, and to demean ourselves with that charity, humility, and temper of mind, which were the characteristics of the divine author of our blessed religion, and without a humble imitation of whose example in these things we can never hope to be a happy nation." Thomas Jefferson wrote in his personal Bible, "I am a real Christian, that is to say, a disciple of the doctrine of Jesus. I have little doubt that our whole country will soon be rallied to the unity of our Creator." We must never forget that we are a nation founded upon Christian values. We are a nation that has opened its borders to millions of people over the years so that they may enjoy the freedoms of our country, that our country provides, and that we are a nation made up of people from all walks of life. When I first went overseas into the Gulf, I had a very misguided perception of the people in the Gulf and their religion. But I will tell you, after spending some time with them, the majority of them as a whole are very good people, great people, faithful people. And just as there's bad people in Islam, there's bad Christians that do awful things. God wants us to love everyone, not just those who agree with us. When I think back on the horrors of what we now call 9/11, I am reminded once again of just how fragile life is. I am reminded that the United States of America is an enemy to some, a refuge of others, and a nation where people should always be treated with respect and, above all, tolerance. That is, until tolerance becomes dangerous. We talked a little bit about this in Bible study, which is also some of that Bible study was placed into this sermon. We are a nation founded on Christian principles and values, and in our tolerance and respect of others, we must not lose sight of our roots. Yes, while we are a nation under God, we must not forget that our nation's God is Jesus Christ. I believe it is more important now than ever before to fill our nation's capital with godly people who will be tolerant of others, to respect differences, but not compromise on their own beliefs. President Obama offered these words in a speech. At a time when the country is anxious, generally, and going through a tough time, then you know fears can surface, suspicions, divisions can surface in a society. We have to make sure we don't start turning on each other. We are one nation under God. And then our president said, and we may call that God different names, but we still remain one nation. Why are we so afraid to stand fast on our principles? Yet still be tolerant of others without compromise? We are one nation under God, founded upon the Bible, the Word of God. One nation, one God. But that's not what it's all about. We need to be accepting. We need to put on Christ's clothing. We need to be more Christ-like. And with that comes tolerance. When we start to change that way, people are going to see who we believe in. And I think they might start to change their hearts too. A few years ago, there was concern over a mosque to be built at Ground Zero. You guys remember that? I'm all about looking back at history. When the Dome of the Rock was built on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem 1,500 years ago, and today there's a lot of concern over a pastor of a small church who ideologically wants to burn the Quran. Yeah, it's true. It's Florida. Florida man. There's always going to be differences, okay? There's always going to be differences in age, race, background, beliefs. But we are one nation. And if we believe what we believe, that one nation is under God, one God. And that God is compassionate. He shows mercy. He gives grace. And if we believe that, guess what? We have to show compassion. We have to show mercy. We have to show grace. We need to love people unconditionally, just as Christ has done for us. Have we learned a lesson from September 11th? Which doesn't seem like that long ago. There was another time and another place where terrorism was rampant. A great fire broke out, and this entire city was engulfed in flames. Hundreds of public buildings were burned to the ground. Hundreds of acres were blackened in the city, and thousands of homes were destroyed, so that there were thousands of inhabitants of the city left homeless. The month was July. The year was 64 AD. Just a little over 30 years since the crucifixion and resurrection. The burning city was none other than Rome itself. history has concluded that Emperor Nero set that fire in order that he might destroy the ramshackle buildings of Rome and give him room to erect some marble palaces and other monuments that he thought would establish his name in history. It was during this time, of course, that the story was born that Nero fiddled with while Rome burned. Fiddled like played. But it is pretty clear from there's no conclusive evidence, okay, that's actually what happened. In fact, the violin wasn't even invented yet in 64 AD. So but what he played is hard to tell, but it is pretty clear from some contemporary Christians that the emperor was seen looking over the city and enjoying the view while it burned. There are some who claim that when the fire was put out in one part of the city, suddenly and mysteriously, it was lit again. So the historians of that day seem to be almost unanimous in concluding that Nero did burn down the city. The Roman citizens were incensed. They were ready to revolt and overthrow him. So Nero, quick thinking, looked around for a scapegoat that he could blame for the fire. There was in Rome a group of people who were just in the right situation to lend themselves to take the blame for that fire. And they were called Christians. And they followed a man named Christ. And the vicious Emperor Nero started the rumor around Rome that these Christians had burned down the city. There were many people who refused to believe that, but there was a lot of people who did. And in order to enforce it, the emperor began a very serious series of persecutions against the Christians. And it was during that time that the Christians were burned as torches to light the gardens of Nero. That was when he actually threw an outdoor party. He used Christians as his lamp. They were the light of the world. They were tied to his chariot and dragged through the streets of Rome until they were dead. They were thrown to the lions. They were sought after and faced horrible persecution daily. Now, it was during this time of severe persecution when the Apostle Peter wrote his wonderful letter we know as 1 Peter. He wrote this letter to encourage his fellow believers wherever they were, whatever difficulties they were enduring. At the end of this letter, Peter says he wrote it from Babylon. There are some who say he meant the literal Babylon on the Euphrates River, but most scholars agree that he was using the term as a code, if you will, that was common amongst the Christians of the century to refer to Rome. Because of all of the idolatry and evil of Babylon had now been transferred to the capital of the Roman Empire. So according to Ray Stedman, this is one of the letters in the New Testament especially helpful to anybody who is going through any kind of difficulty. If you are facing the problem of suffering of any kind at all, I urge you to read 1 Peter. If you are wondering what God is doing in the world of our day and what is going to happen in the face of all the tensions and pressures and possibilities of terror that await us in the future, this is an excellent letter to read because it was written to Christians under similar circumstances. Peter begins with the greatest fact in life of any Christian, his relationship to Jesus Christ with his new birth. And Peter says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, we have been born anew and have been given a living hope. In the face of persecution, in the face of craziness in our world today, in the face of anything that can be potentially harmful, we all have hope. Christ Jesus. He's the way, he's the truth, he's the life. And no one, not a single person, comes to the Father except through him. What I did today was I went from Old Testament all the way to the New Testament on purpose. No matter what you're going through in life, you got the answer. And lollipops. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for these words today, Lord. Keep this message in the back of our heads. In fact, ingrain it in our hearts. That, Lord, you do have all the answers. All we have to do is read. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. Choose your... I don't think I got enough. I got more. Don't worry. I got more.
Grab one.
I got more.
Number 154.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your I'm sorry, Lord.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we go about this very difficult week for many of us, Lord, we just ask you to be with each and every single one of us, to remind us that we need to have unity under you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.